Welcome to session 3 of module 3. In session 2, we had seen the two popular UML models used for representing the design details, used for graphically illustrating our design plans. Okay. So, the two models were the process model. So, we understood process model is represented with a starting point, a set or series of activities, and an end point. So, we had seen appropriate notations for the process model. Next, after process model, we started with interaction models. Okay. So, interaction model is emphasizing on the interaction between the different components, okay, or the different entities in the system. So, we have two ways of presenting interaction details. One was using UML modeling, the other one was using sequence diagram. So, emphasis in UML modeling was basically on the stakeholders or external entities and how they interact with the system. Okay, so here emphasis was towards the interaction between the stakeholder and the system. The second one was the sequence diagram. See, what was missing in the first one, that is in UML representation, was we had just specified this specific stakeholder interacting with this system or software. But we did not mention the sequence. Okay. So, for more clarity, I'll just give you a small example. Now, through UML modeling, I can represent what are the type of interactions a receptionist can do with a patient monitoring software. It can typically be registering a new patient, helping or assisting a patient book an appointment, storing the registrations of the patient to the database. See, all these interactions that could be done by the receptionist with the software will be modeled in use case. Okay. Now, the exact sequence that happens during interaction, so that will not be modeled or that cannot be modeled using use case. So, if you want to present those design details, what is the sequence that is happening? Okay. So, in this specific interaction, so we need to take up the next modeling technique. That is sequence modeling or sequence diagram, which is under interaction diagram. Okay. In sequence modeling, what we can do? So, just now you had taken an example of a receptionist being able to book an appointment or confirm an appointment for the patient. Now, what is the set or series of steps that are followed in this process? Okay. First, who should initiate the request? After that, what happens? For example, the patient may use a web platform to send a request to the receptionist for booking an appointment on a specific date and time. The receptionist will receive this request. Okay. Now, after receiving the request, the receptionist will check the availability of the doctor on that date. He or she will also check whether any other appointments have been scheduled on that day and time. Once it has been verified and once the doctor confirms his availability, the receptionist will give the confirmation back to the patient. So, we can see the patient has been confirmed with the registration after a series of events. Okay. And we observe it is in a time series fashion. First, the patient sending the request to the receptionist, next receptionist verifying the schedule of the doctor. And once done with it, then the receptionist was once again informing back the patient. Okay. So, the steps that are happening in this interaction has been or will be illustrated using a graphical modeling technique, that is sequence diagram. In session 2, we had seen what is sequence diagram and the different notations that are used in sequence diagram. In session 2, we had also understood the importance of following standard notations when you are building, presenting a model. Reason being, if you start using your own notations, if you start using your own way of presenting things, so your design plan may not reach the audience or the person who is going through your document or your graphical model. So the message may not be clear to him. He may come out with his own interpretations. He may assume things that should not happen. That is the case. What you want to convey may not reach the target audience in an effective way. Okay. So, we had a solution for this. What was the solution? the solution was, let us use standard notations in our graphical models. Okay. So we had explored the same in context model. We had seen to present a system or other systems present in the environment of the software, we were using a rectangular block with the name of the software written at the center, and above at the top center portion of that rectangular box, we were using the keyword system within angular brackets. In similar lines, for the process model, we had used various notations to indicate the start of the process, to indicate the end of the process, to indicate the various stages or different activities in the process. We had used various notations. So we had explored this in the last session. So in today's session, that is in session 3, so we shall start with an example for sequence diagram. Last session, we had explored the different notations, the standard notations in sequence diagram. Now we will utilize those notations for a specific scenario in a patient monitoring software, and we will try to present it as a sequence diagram. We will try to present our plans as a sequence diagram or a sequence model. Okay. So the example under consideration is once again the receptionist confirming an appointment to the patient. Okay. So the patient has initiated a request to the receptionist. Maybe we'll assume it may be through a web portal. Okay. So the request of the patient has been received by the receptionist. The next step by the receptionist is she should confirm the availability of the doctor to the patient. Okay. Now, just now I explained what are the steps that should be followed before confirming the appointment. Okay. Now we will present this using sequence diagram. Okay. So in sequence diagram, so at the very top portion, we represent the different entities, components, classes, objects, which are part of the scenario. Okay. Now our scenario is a receptionist checking whether the schedule can be confirmed to the patient. Now, who are the ones who will be involved in this scenario? Okay. Who are the ones who will be involved in this sequence? Okay. So we will be writing that in the topmost row in rectangular blocks. And stakeholders or actors will be written with the stick-like figure that we have already used in UML. So to start with, so we have our receptionist. Okay. So our receptionist, a stick-like figure will be utilized for the receptionist. Now, who are the other actors or entities or objects or components who will be part of interaction in this sequence? So one will be the patient information system. Okay, so I will call it as a PI, meaning that the patient information system, the part of the patient monitoring system responsible for maintaining the patient information. Okay, so we will even specify the object related to that. We'll prefix it to a colon. So here I have specified it to be P. Okay. Next, we will have a database where there is a patient details, registration details, okay, and the credentials of the receptionist will be stored. So that is also an entity here. So I will call it as the patient monitoring system DB. Okay. DB stands for database, PMSs, patient monitoring software. Now, what is there inside this database? So as already mentioned, it will contain the details of the patient and also the credentials of the receptionist. Okay. The credentials of the receptionist will be stored. How it will be utilized, we will see. How it will be utilized in a time series fashion. So we will explore it. Okay. We have one more system responsible for verifying the authenticity of a stakeholder who is using this software. Okay. Also, I will call this database through the object D. So next one is the authorization system, which will check whether the person who is trying to access the database has the required credentials, whether he or she can access that specific data that is being requested. Okay, so that will be done through the authorization system, and you can see the object for the authorization system, it is A. So our topmost row is containing the different entities, the different components or classes or objects which are part of the interaction. So in our specific scenario that we have taken as an example, where a receptionist is checking the availability of the doctor, okay, so that he or she can confirm to the patient. So this has been written in the topmost row. In the last session, I had explained the sequence diagram is represented in a time series fashion. Okay, so it has been presented as a dotted line, as we can see here. So it is written as a dotted line. So now, what is the significance of this dotted line? So as I had already illustrated in the last session, so time is flowing in this fashion. As we move down this vertical bar, which is represented as a dotted line, time is increasing. So that is what we need to understand. Okay. So now, we will assume the receptionist has received a request for scheduling an appointment. Okay. So now the receptionist should view the patient information. So before confirming the appointment, okay. So the scenario is the receptionist will access the patient information. Okay. So patient information should be accessed by the receptionist prior to confirming the appointment. So now we will assume that the receptionist has received a request for an appointment by the patient. Okay. Now the receptionist wants to view the information of the patient in the database. So the information should be visualized by the receptionist. Okay. So now the receptionist will send a request to the patient information system. So we know the notation for sending a request or for sending a message. So it's a solid arrow. Okay, solid arrow indicating that a message has been sent from the receptionist to the patient information system, and type of message we can write above this line. So receptionist wants to view the information of the patient. Okay. And which patient? Okay. So the ID will be sent. PID stands for ID of the patient. Whose information the receptionist wants to access, so that she can confirm the appointment for the patient. Okay. Now, please note, the receptionist is active in this duration. Okay. So, when the receptionist is active, we will write an activation bar, as already explained in the last session. So, we have an activation bar. When the activation bar will close, okay. So now, if the receptionist is no more active, the activation bar will close. But now still the receptionist is active. Okay, so now we will focus on this object. Okay, the PI, the patient information system. Okay. So now the receptionist is requesting for the information of the patient. Okay, the request has been sent to PI, the patient information system. Okay. Now the patient information system does not have the details of the patient. So the details are stored in the database. Meaning to say that this request now in turn will be forwarded to the database. Okay. Now, shall I immediately start the request line here itself? No. The reason being, See, to receive this request, to process this request, some time will be consumed. Okay. So the next request from the PI, so I need to go below here somewhere and then draw a solid line with a solid arrowhead. So please try to understand the significance of why I have written the solid arrow below. I've not started it immediately. So reason being, the small duration that you are seeing here, okay, it was the duration of receiving the request and processing the request. Okay, so after it was done, so the request was forwarded to the database. Reason being, basically information of the patient is stored in the database. So it is not under the possession of the patient information system. So it can only send a request to that database. Now, what will be there in that request? So that request will have, an indicator that the database should send a report of what? Okay, this specific information, I'll call it as info, of whom? Of that patient with the PID, and a receptionist will also have a ID using which we can uniquely identify a receptionist in the hospital. So I will call it as UID. So once again, I'll brief out here. So the patient information system has received a request from the receptionist to view the information of the patient. Okay. So this request was taken by the patient information system, but it is not present in the patient information system, but it is stored in a database, which is a different component. So now the patient information system took the request and it sent a request for a report to the database. Now, what are the arguments or parameters passed as part of this request? So the first argument or first parameter is the type of information. Okay, so type of information the receptionist wants, whether it is maybe the name of the patient, whether it's the mobile number of the patient, or whether it is information like whether he's active, I mean whether he's still active with respect to the registration, or whether his registration has been cancelled with the hospital. Or it may be like something like the address of the patient. So it may be any information, any details about the patient, what information the receptionist wants. So is the first parameter. Information of which patient? Is it that of Anil, Sunil, Kumar? Hundreds of patients will be there. So if the receptionist wants to know the information of the patient Anil, so his ID, which is unique to Anil, will be the second parameter. Now, this receptionist will also have an ID, so that becomes the third parameter. So, totally three parameters have been sent with the request for the report. So, now this will reach the patient monitoring software database system. Now, do you think immediately the database should send the report to the receptionist or to the patient monitoring system or to the receptionist? Once a request is received, should it immediately send the report? Definitely not. It will be something like you type gmail.com and immediately all your emails are given to you. That should not happen. So the database system should check whether this person, this component, this object who is sending a request, for some resource, for some data, is having the required credentials, is having the required authorization to access it. Please note, here receptionist is requesting for some information, for some data from the database, through PI. So now the database should verify whether this receptionist is having the required authentication, is having the required authorization to access it. How it is done? So without authorization, without verifying whether the receptionist can access it, so database will not generate the report and it will not give it to the receptionist. So meaning to say that the database system in turn will send, will check for the authenticity of the request, credibility of the request with the authorization system. Okay, so authorization system will have all the details like which user can access what file, what type of resource. Okay, for example, receptionist can just access the name of the patient, mobile number, address, email ID, that's it. Okay, maybe she cannot access the diagnosis details of the patient. It is only accessible to the doctor. Okay, so like this we can define the access control at different levels. We can restrict the access control only to maybe some primary information like name or address, or even we can provide access at the next level like accessing the records of the patient. Okay, so these details will be managed by the authorization system, or to put it in simple words, what can be accessed by the receptionist or what and what cannot be accessed. So these details will be present with the authorization system. Okay, so now the database system, before sending, I mean generating the report and sending back to the receptionist, it will check whether receptionist can access it, this data that has been requested. So whether that can be accessed by the receptionist, so that will be checked, that will be verified by the authorization system, and that can happen only if the database system sends the request to the authorization system. Okay, so now once again, I'll not start immediately, I'll leave some time here. Okay, I'll go below through this vertical timeline, and already I've explained its significance. I'll draw a solid line with the solid arrowhead. Okay, fine. So now what is happening here? The database system is asking to authorize. Authorize what? So authorize whether this requested info can be given to this user with this specific ID. Already I mentioned each and every user. It may be a receptionist, it may be a doctor, it may be a nurse, it may be a manager in the hospital. So they will have their own unique ID. And also everyone cannot access everything. Okay, we have access control. Who can access what will be very clearly defined by the authorization system. So now the database has forwarded or sent a request to the authorization system that can I give this information to this receptionist. So that is the meaning here. Okay, now the authorization system will become active, it will start the processing. Already I mentioned the authorization system is having the details of each and every user of the patient monitoring system, what they can access, what they cannot access. Now this is the duration during which that computation was done by the authorization system. Okay, so I have written a rectangular block here indicating that the authorization system was active during this period. Okay, now the authorization system has determined whether the receptionist can access or not. Okay, now whatever response was generated out of computation, it will be sent back as a response. And already in the last session we have understood the response is indicated, okay, by a dotted line in the reverse direction with a solid arrowhead. Okay, so a solid arrowhead, so this is the response. Now what type of response? See, this response is for the authorized request. Okay, so this response is authorized authorization, whether the receptionist is authorized to view this information or not. So that information will be sent from the authorization component to the database component. Okay, so now also please note, this was the period during which the database system was activated. Okay, and it's still active now. Has received the authorization, it's still active. So indicated by this rectangular block on the timeline. Okay. Now, with respect to authorization, there may be two possibilities. One possibility is the receptionist is not authorized to view the resource or information, or the receptionist is authorized to view the information. It is something like a if-else statement. Okay, if true something, if false a different thing. Okay, so the same case here, two possibilities can exist here. One is the receptionist is authorized, or the receptionist is not authorized. Okay, so when we have a duality here, okay, when we have two possibilities, so already I have mentioned the notation that should be used in the sequence diagram. So it is an alt box. Okay, so we will be using the alt box here in the sequence diagram, okay, to indicate the two possibilities that can exist or that can happen because of this response. What are the two possibilities? Okay, so I'll be marking an alt box here. So alt stands for possible alternatives. So since it is with respect to the receptionist, so I'll be writing the alt notation here. Okay. Now, what are the possibilities that can exist in this case? So now the database system will receive the response. Okay, what may be in that response? Two possibilities. One is receptionist is authorized to view the information of the patient and confirm the appointment. That is one possibility. Second possibility is she is not authorized to view the information of the patient. Okay, so these two things we will represent using the alt box. Okay, in the first scenario, the first case, if the receptionist is authorized to view the information, so the patient information will be sent as a response to the PI. Okay, patient information is given. So please note, when the patient information was given by the database, okay, so that is in first case, that is when the receptionist was found to be authorized to use that information. Okay, so this is the case when the receptionist is authorized. So we will write it within square brackets, okay, at the receptionist end. So this conveys that, so if the receptionist is authorized, he or she will receive the patient information through the PI. Now what is the other possibility? The other possibility is the receptionist may receive an error message. Please note, we are dealing with the response. So that is the reason we are using a dotted line with a solid arrowhead. Okay, a dotted line with a solid arrowhead. Okay. So we are exploring the next possibility, the second possibility that can happen, that is error. No access. When the database will inform that it's an error, this request is an error, and you will not be given with the access. When the database will inform it to the PI, anyhow, which in turn will be informed to the receptionist. That is when the authorization system found that the receptionist is not authorized to view that information. Then the same was informed here as a response. Okay, and we understood it was one of the alternatives. Two alternatives were there. One is the patient information being served by the database to the PI, which in turn was given to the receptionist. The second alternative is because of failure in authorization, so an error message may be sent to the PI, which in turn is sent to the receptionist. So the two alternatives, the two possibilities have been explored, have been represented through the alt box. So now the second possibility has been indicated, error message. Okay. And what the receptionist should understand here. Okay. So the receptionist should understand that authorization has failed. So there is a failure in the authorization. Okay. So this was a sequence diagram of the receptionist accessing the patient information from a database, and that was through authorization. Okay. So when the receptionist requested the information, it was not immediately given. Okay. We are following the process step by step in a time series fashion. Okay, so it's a time series fashion. So a receptionist who wants to view the information of a patient has sent a request to the PI. Okay, the PI in turn has sent the request to the database, because actually the information is stored in the database. The database did not immediately give the information to the PI to forward it to the receptionist. It has checked the credentials of the receptionist. It has verified whether the receptionist is authorized to view that information. Okay. And after the authorization system does the required computation, okay, so it will inform about the authorization status, which can be of two possibilities. The same has been represented in the alt box. The two possibilities are, the first one being the information given to the receptionist. Okay. Meaning to say that the receptionist should understand, yes, he or she was authorized. The second possibility is an error message being received, in which case the receptionist should understand that the authorization has failed. So this was a time series presentation of the complete scenario, starting from the beginning to the end, okay, of a specific scenario. Okay. Also, as I informed, the duration during which that entity will be active will be represented, okay, so through a rectangle on the timeline. Okay, yeah, the same I have not written here. So even for the PI, we have a rectangle here, meaning to say that this was the duration during which the PI was active. This was the duration during which the database was active. Okay, and even here also. Okay, so this was the duration during which the receptionist was active. Okay. To summarize, receptionist, PI, and DB, they are active for the whole period. But please note, the authorization system is not active for the complete duration on the timeline. Okay, it is only active for the duration during which it has received the request to authorize, did the computation, and just sent the response with respect to the authorization. So this was the duration it was active. That's it. Now, after this duration, it does not have any scope in this scenario. So we have continued with the dotted line. Okay. So if there is scope for the specific component being active, so we will continue with the rectangular block. Else we will close it and we will continue with the dotted line. Okay. Now assume that the authorization system was active once again at some other point here. Yes, we can open one more rectangular box here, which we even call as the activation bar. Okay. You can open once again and you can close it if its scope is limited at that part. So what I want to convey here is you can have multiple activation bars, so which may be active or inactive at different time intervals. Okay. So this was an example for the sequence diagram. Okay. So we completed the sequence diagram, which was a type of interaction diagram. We also explored scenario, an example where we represented the receptionist accessing the patient information for confirming the appointment for a patient. Okay, so this flow in a time series fashion has been represented using this sequence diagram. Okay, So we completed with this part, the first one. So next we will take up with the structural models. So the interaction model that we have explored in the last session and even in this session through UML and the sequence diagram. So they were dynamic. Okay. So they were illustrating the dynamic behavior of the software. Okay. So we have the next one, the next type of modeling using UML called as structural model. So we'll try to understand what is structural model and when we can go with structural models. What type of design plans can be presented using structural model? Okay. So first point here is, see, structural model is static. Okay. It can only present static information about the software or system. You cannot present dynamic information, okay, like what are the different stages, what are the different steps that are happening as part of a process, what are the different types of interaction that is happening, okay, what was sent during an interaction, what was received during an interaction. So these details cannot be presented using structural models. Okay. So structural model, as the name itself is indicating, is focused towards the structure of the system, different components, the different parts, okay, and how a part is related to another part. So with this emphasis, with this focus, we present our design details in structural models. Okay. So we had already dealt with one of the popular ways of presenting the design details of the software by taking into consideration the static behavior of the software. So one of the most popular ways of doing it is using the class diagram. Okay, so the same we will be exploring here. So if you just try to recap module 2, so you will be able to remember we had explored this aspect of the design in module 2, which was object-oriented modeling. Okay, so we had used class diagrams. We had represented the design details using class diagrams. So now what is a class, how to present the class details, it was already explained in module 2. So now it will be like a revision here at this point. Okay. Now whatever real world entities we identify from the client requirements, okay, we group it into classes. So that is what we had seen in module 2. Okay. And we also understood we can have n number of classes for a typical software, okay, which is complex. So many classes will be there. Now what is the notation we use for presenting a class, okay, for modeling a class? So we'll explore it. So the very first aspect here is the class notation. So what notation we will be using for a class? Okay. So these details were already presented in module 2. So just I'll rebrush it. So we come out with a rectangular block with three parts or three sections. Okay. The first section will contain the name of the class. Okay. And it should be written in the center with the first letter in uppercase. Also, to make it significant, we make it bold and italic. Okay. So the class name should be written in the center. It should be bold and also it should be italic so that it can appear significantly in the block. Okay. So the first block, the first part in our rectangular block is containing the name of the class. Okay. Now what is there in the second block? So the second block will have the attributes. What are attributes? Attributes are nothing but properties, characteristics of the class. See, it may be a living entity or a non-living entity. So it will have its own set of attributes or qualities through which you can uniquely identify that entity. Okay. For example, if it's a human being, hands, legs, eyes, nose, okay, he's able to walk. So these are few qualities, few attributes, a name, age, mobile number. Okay. So these are attributes for a person or a human being. So if it is for a car will have a color, model number. Okay, these are a few qualities or attributes through which you can identify a car. So that will fit into the second block, okay, that is the attributes. Okay. Now each and every class can perform some actions, some activities. Okay. What is that action that can be performed by this class? So that will be part of the third block. Okay. So actions that can be performed by the class. Okay. So this is a typical general form of a class. We understood a class is written within a rectangular block. This is a graphical illustration with the class name being predominant at the top. The attributes in the second block and the actions in the third block. Okay. Now this was a general form. Now we will become more specific with the example. Okay. So we'll create few classes which will help us improvise on the clarity with respect to what is the class and how to write the attributes and actions or operations. Actions or even it can be operations. So I'll take my very first class, class student. So we are now into the examples for classes. So class examples. Now my very first example is that of a student class. As usual, I will divide this into three blocks. So this is a student class. I have written the class name in the center, the first letter in uppercase. Okay, predominantly it is bold, and also you can make it as italic. Okay. This was the class name. Now we will try to identify few qualities, few attributes, few properties of a student. Okay, through using which you can uniquely identify that he is a student. Okay, he's not a teacher, he's not a professor. Okay, maybe he's not an employee in some XYZ company, but he's a student. Now, what are those attributes, those qualities which can uniquely define that yes, this class is that of a student? Okay, now we are aware any student is uniquely identified through a register number, roll number, or a maybe USN. So that may be the first one. A student will have a name, a student will have a mobile number. Okay. A student may be wearing a uniform with a specific color. See, these are a few properties, few attributes, okay, few qualities in a student which can be used to uniquely identify a student. Okay. So that becomes part of our second block, which is attributes. Now the third one. So already I mentioned the third block, third part in the class notation is dealing with actions or operations associated with the class. Now what are the actions or operations that can be done by a student? What activities can be done by a student, which is once again unique to a student? So the actions can be like a student can attend the class. Please note, it is indicating an action, some activity. Okay. See, USN name is not an action. Okay. But attending, it's an action, action verb. Okay. A student can attend the class. The student can write exams. Okay. He is writing the exams. That is also an action verb. So this was an example class, class student. So we understood how to construct a class for the student entity. I'll take one more example. Okay. So the second example is that of the class car. So class car, I have written in the center with C in uppercase, fine. Now, can we define few qualities, few attributes, few properties using which you can uniquely identify that yes, this is a car. Yes, we can do it, okay. By seeing the model, by seeing the color, by seeing the shape, yes, you can identify this is a car. Okay. Now, what are the operations or actions associated with a car that can be done by a car? Okay. Obviously, a car cannot attend class. Okay. That action is not possible. I cannot write it here. A car cannot take exam. But these are the possibilities with a car. Okay. What is it? So it can turn left. It's action, please note. Okay. It can move forward. It can move. It can turn left. It can turn right. Okay. So these are some actions that are possible with the car. Okay. So that becomes part of the third block inside this rectangular illustration, graphical block. So we understood what is the structural model. And we also understood how structural models are illustrated. So it was through class diagrams. Okay. Now going to the third part, relationship between the classes. So now we will take, try to understand the relationship between the classes. Just now I made a point. Okay, we have classes identified as part of the design, and those classes are presented graphically using structural models, which are design models, okay, which is a type of design model. Now the big question here is how many classes are there in a typical software? Maybe a simple software or a complex software. How many classes may be there? Okay. So obviously it goes without saying. So the number of classes will be n, where n can take any value depending on the complexity of the software. So if you just remember the patient monitoring software which we are discussing from module 1, okay. Now what is the possibility that can exist with respect to structural modeling or class diagrams? Okay. So for a patient monitoring system, we can have different classes like doctor. So doctor can be one class, receptionist a class, patient he's a different class. Manager in the hospital, a different class. A nurse who's assisting the doctor, a different class. Ambulance in the hospital, it belongs to a different class, class vehicle. Okay. So what I want to convey here is a typical software will have n number of classes. Okay. I'll call it as class A, class B, class C. I'll generalize it. Okay. So many classes are there. Class A, class B. We can have many classes in a typical complex software. Now, the big question in front of you, are classes independent or are they dependent on one another? Are the classes working on their own? or is it interacting with other classes? Okay. So with a small simple analysis, you can easily deduce the classes are not independent. A class or a component cannot work on its own to give the desired outcome. Okay. They are interacting with one another. They are dependent on one another. They are communicating with one another. Okay. For example, consider the patient monitoring software. The two classes in the patient monitoring software, class patient, class doctor. Class patient is class 1, class doctor is the second class. Now, do you think class patient can just be independent in this patient monitoring software? Definitely not. See, the class patient should interact with class doctor. Class patient should interact with class receptionist. Okay. Class patient, maybe he may need to interact with a class vehicle. Okay, if he is using a vehicle to come to the hospital, we'll assume that he is coming through an ambulance. He needs to use that class. So the point here is classes are not independent. They are interacting with one another. They are related to one another, and that is the key idea behind this discussion. There is some relationship between the classes. Now, what type of relationship can exist here? Okay. So once again, this was already explored in module 2. So we understood two classes which are related, okay, related to one another is indicated through a solid line connecting the two classes, and we call this relationship as association. Okay, it's association. Two classes, class A and class B, related to one another. How it has been represented in our graphical model? A solid line connecting the two classes. And if that is the case, we call it as association. Now, we had seen many examples for this in module 2, just to have a recap of it. So, we have a class, class student. Okay. So, class student and class university. So, class student, class university. Now, do you think both the classes are independent? Definitely not. Okay. So both the classes are related to one another. They are dependent on one another. Student is dependent on university. University is dependent on student to function. Okay. So now, how you present these design details in this modeling? I draw a straight line here, a solid line. Okay. So indicating that the student class is related to the class university. I can even demonstrate the multiplicity here, the how many instances. Okay. So one university and many students, indicated by n at the student end and one at the university end. So all these details were already explored in module 2, so I'll not go in depth into it. But the point here is you need to recap, or you need to remember that classes are not independent, they are related to one another, okay, they will be interacting with one another, and typically we represent this relationship through association. Okay. So that was what we understood in module 2. Okay. So now we will extend this discussion, and we will try to see the types of association, what types of association can be there. So the very first type of association that can exist is aggregation. Okay. So aggregation is also called as shared association. One more name for aggregation. Okay. And the type of relation here is, okay, so it's part of a relationship. I'll take an example for clarity. Okay, assume we have a class. Okay, I'll call it as a class थर्ड सेमेस्टर. सो माई द नेम ऑफ माई क्लास इज क्लास थर्ड सेमेस्टर. सो दिस इज माई मेन क्लास. सो ऑब्वियसली इन थर्ड सेमेस्टर मेनी स्टूडेंट्स विल बी देयर. ओके, सो दैट विल बी द सब क्लास अंडर दिस मेन क्लास. ओके, आई विल रिप्रेजेंट इट एज स्टूडेंट वन. Student 2 up to student n. So my main class here is class third semester, and student 1 to n is the subclass. Okay. Now, is there any relationship between the subclass and the main class? Do you think some relationship can exist? Yes, definitely. See, all students are part of third semester. Okay, they are part of third semester. That is the relationship that exists between student and the student class and the third semester class. Okay. Now, I can just draw a straight line here to indicate it's a association. But I have very specifically mentioned this. We are trying to present a type of association called as aggregation or shared association. Okay. So the notation for that is a hollow diamond with a line from the main class to the subclass. Okay. So a hollow diamond from the main class to the subclass indicates it's an aggregation. What does it mean? Okay, so all the subclasses, student 1, student 2, student 3, okay, so all together, okay, so they form a whole relationship, that is third semester. Okay. Now, there is one more speciality of this aggregation relationship. What is it? Okay, see, the subclass can independently exist even without the main class. It is not like the main class should be there for the subclass to exist. So there can be an independent existence of the subclass in reference to the main class. What does it mean? For example, now a student, student one, for example, Anil, he was in third semester. Now, because of some reasons, he could not continue in third semester, or maybe he has taken a change of college, okay, or a change of branch. So we could not have him in third semester. Now, does that mean that student one does not exist? Does that mean that Anil does not exist from now on onwards? Definitely not. He can exist. Okay. Previously, Anil was associated with third semester because of some reasons. Now he could not continue in third semester. That does not mean that Anil cannot exist. Still he can exist independent of the base class. Okay. So this type of relation is what we call as aggregation. Okay. So all the subclasses, student 1, 2, 3. So student 1, 2, 3 up to n are all subclasses. So all the subclasses together can be aggregated, can be associated with the base class. Okay, all students 1 to n can be part of third semester. Okay, but also a subclass can exist independent of the base class. Okay, so this was a base class, so this is a subclass. So as I already mentioned, Anil can exist even if the third semester, even after he has left the third semester. Okay, so that is a speciality of aggregation. So this was the first type of relationship and association between the classes, and our focus is base class to subclass. Okay, so the first one was aggregation. The aggregation relationship between classes. So the second one is the composition. So the composition relationship between classes. So composition is even called as a not shared association. Now, what is this composition? We'll try to understand. Okay. I'll take a different example which can help you achieve more clarity. Okay. But the scenario is same. We have a base class, we have subclasses, and there is a relationship between base class and subclass. All the things are same, but what type of relationship? We'll try to understand. Okay. So now, if base class is Anil, Anil is a person. Okay. Anil is a person. Yes. I'll use the standard notation itself. Okay. Now, what are the subclasses that can be associated with Anil? Okay, who's a person? Okay. So, Anil will have hands. Okay, that can be one subclass. Please note, Anil will have legs. One more subclass. Okay. Now, why you have taken this example? See, please note, all subclasses together associated forms the base class. Now, you may start thinking it is same as the previous one, the association, aggregation. Okay. In that case also it was the same, all subclasses together was the base class. Then now what is the difference? Okay. So the difference here is, now if I remove the base class, can the subclasses exist? Okay. For example, if I remove the person Anil, now can the subclasses, hands, legs, eyes, nose, can it exist independent of the base class? Okay. So can the hands of Anil exist independently without Anil? Can it exist? Can it thrive? Okay. Definitely not. So please try to understand, in the composition relationship, okay, so all the subclasses together, okay, it will realize the composition of the base class, and subclasses cannot exist independently in reference to the base class. Okay. So this type of association between the base class and the subclasses is what we call as composition. Okay. There is no sharing here. It's part of it. So very strongly, tightly coupled association or relationship, okay, which you cannot separate. So that was the composition relationship. So we understood the two types of association, that is aggregation and composition. The third one being generalization. What is generalization? So we had seen generalization and inheritance. So this was already explored in module 2. So I'll just have a recap of it so that you can remember, and the explanation can make sense. Okay. What is generalization? So if you remember one of the topics in module 2, okay, so generalization to specialization, and how generalization can be used in inheritance. So you can make sense of what is being discussed. Okay. Generalization typically extracts common characteristics among different classes. So for example, I have two classes here. Class B. Oh, just for the sake of explanation, I'll call it as class B. There is one more class, class C. Please see, these are specialized classes. We'll assume these are specialized classes with its own properties, own attributes and operations. But still, can we handpick a few attributes, few qualities, few operations which are common to both the classes? Okay, can we do it? Can we handpick few things which are common between class B and class C? Okay, and if you are successful in that attempt, You can take it and put it in one more class, okay, which we call as a general class. So generalization involves, okay, a bottom-up approach where you consider specialized subclasses. From the specialized subclasses, you will identify a few things which are common to all the subclasses, and you construct a base class. Okay. So we are moving from specialization to generalization. This is what we had explored in module 2. Okay. Now, still, if you are not able to make sense of the explanation, we will take some examples which are realistic, which can help you improvise on your clarity. Okay. Now, I will consider class B to be that of class dog and class C to be that of class cat. Okay. Now, what are the attributes? What are the qualities using which you can use? You can identify a dog. Okay. Yes, maybe name. Okay. So color and a few qualities of a dog, like dogs are a bit aggressive. It's one of the quality of a dog. It's a bit comparatively, it's aggressive. It is territorial. We are aware of it. Okay. If someone invades, if someone enters their territory, they become very aggressive. Okay. So it's a quality of a dog. So we have listed the three qualities of dogs. I mean, once again, it's an exhaustive list. Now coming to the cat. Okay. So even a cat is having a name, color, and the nature of the cat, maybe comparatively it is mild compared to a dog. Cat is mild. Okay. It is not so aggressive and territorial. Now, what are the actions a cat or dog can do? Okay. Maybe a cat or a dog, it can walk, it can run. Even a cat can do the same. It can walk, it can run. Please note the entries that are made being made in the third block is representing the actions, action verbs. Okay. Is there something very specific to a dog? Okay. That is not there with a cat in terms of the actions. Yes, definitely. A dog can bark. Okay. A dog can bark, which cannot be done by the cat. That is the reason I mentioned it's a specialized class. This is a subclass which is specialized, which is very specific. Okay. Now the same thing carries here. Can a cat do something which is very unique to cat that cannot be done by the dog? Yes. The type of sound that is generated, okay, meow sound, it's unique to a cat. It cannot be done, I mean, these syllables cannot be generated by the dog. Okay. So we now have two specialized classes, cat and dog. The big question here is, can you handpick few qualities, few attributes or few actions which are common between class dog and class cat? Can we do it? Definitely, we can do it. We can see it may be a dog or a cat. Okay. So it has a name, a pet name. Okay. Color. Yeah, color, second one. The nature, you cannot select this because a dog is aggressive, a cat is mild. This was in terms of attributes, qualities. Coming to the actions, a dog can walk, a dog can run. The same applicable here. A cat can walk, a cat can run. We cannot select this barking, which is very specific to the dog. We cannot select this sound, which is very specific to a cat. So now we have identified few qualities, few properties, few attributes and actions which can be generalized across all the subclasses, across cat and dog in my example. So we will take it and we will put it in a base class. Okay. And we are creating a separate class here and we'll give a general name. So it may be a cat or it may be a dog. So basically it's an animal. So please note I have given a general name, okay, and few qualities which we identified to be common between cat and dog. So we'll be writing it here. So name, color. I'm not including aggressive or mild nature because it's very specific to dog and cat. I'm handpicking few actions which are once again common to both cat and dog, which includes walking, running. Please note, I have not included the typical sounds being made by those specific animals, okay, which are very unique. I'm not picking this, the bark sound and the meow sound. Okay. So this class that I have created, this class which is general, which has general qualities and actions of all the subclasses. So this is what we call as generalization. Okay. Where we are moving from specific to general. I'm moving this direction. So now we understood there is a main class. Okay, fine. And there are subclasses which are related. And the type of relation is generalization. Now how we represent it graphically. Okay. So it's simple, very simple. So I draw a line between the subclass and the main class. But if I just draw a line, it indicates its association. And now we want to become more specific and we want to say that it's a generalization. So in that case, we use a triangle, an empty triangle, which indicates it's a generalization. So we are using a hollow triangle head between the base subclass and the main class. Okay, same thing here, between cat and animal, we use empty triangle head, hollow triangle head. It's not a solid triangle head, it's a hollow triangle head. Okay. So this was the relationship between the classes. We understood classes cannot have independent existence. They need to communicate with one another. They need to interact with one another. So that was presented using relationship. And the different types of relationships that can exist between the classes were explored. The same were discussed with different examples. So in the next session, that is in session 4, we will try to present the structural model of a typical software, a banking software, by illustrating all the relationships in one single model. Okay, so this will be the topic of discussion in session 4, that is the next session. So thank you.